Vedantin. He's a potter. So potter has to have what? Knowledge of pot, correct? How, what the pot looks like. Because you see, if, you know, like I said, I think it has to be rebooted.
No, it's recording. So
it's recording?
Yeah.
So the knowledge of pot is what the pot maker must know, correct? Because otherwise, how will the person make a pot? If you try that clay, that wheel, you know, it looks like a science experiment without knowing. If you keep, you know, molding the clay over it, it will just balloon into something else. It will look like a rakshasa. But if the potter does it, it will look very nice. And sometimes it's so, they make it look so easy. They just take a stick and then just put the wheel and around this pot, and then they'll draw some designs. As the wheel moves, there'll be a little ridge and on the side, and on one side it looks very nice. So the pot maker has the knowledge of the pot. So the knowledge and the material. Now you can say clay, correct? What is the material?
Clay.
So the material and the knowledge are two different things here. We saw this last time. Right? In case of the potter, the material rests with the earth and the knowledge rests in the head of the potter. And the two come together, he has to either go, beg, borrow or buy the material and put, the water is also material, the kiln is also material, all the the wheel is also part of the material, all the raw material he should have, and then he will throw the clay on the wheel and then fashion his knowledge in what the pot that he sees in his head, he brings to life on the wheel, correct? Then afterwards, when he puts and bakes it and takes it to the shop, you know, do you buy the pot maker along with the pot? Pot maker stays, sometimes you don't even know who made this pot, we don't know, correct? Pot is here, the maker of the pot is not here. And this is appropriate. In the whole Jagat, all the knowledge is exactly like that. Now, what about the knowledge of the earth, the Jagat? The knowledge, the one who is wielding the knowledge of everything, this Hara. Where will Hara go for the material? You know, you can go to the neighbor to borrow clay, borrow a cup of sugar, borrow some dough and make chapati. Where will Bhagavan go to make Jagat chapati? Kahan jayega? Where will he go? Huh? So where is the clay for Bhagavan to make this whole Jagat? Where is the raw material? Huh? The Bible will conclude out of nothing he created. We have to add one more word. Nothing else. Yeah. Yeah. It's not wrong. It needs amendment. Out of nothing, what can you create out of nothing? What will come out of nothing? Nothing. But if you say nothing else, it becomes Vedanta. Nothing else other than itself. Other than himself, nothing else. So from the point of view of the raw material, we say she. From the point of view of the maker, we say he. That's all. Why? Because there is raw material, creative, shakti and all is there. That's why it is a... It is coded as feminine, and this very same Upanishad is going to say that later, that because of this Maya, Indro Maya Bhihi Puru Rupam Eti, it will say that later. So Puru Rupam means Bahu Rupam, many forms this one has taken, as it were. So the raw material is nothing but knowledge, really speaking. There is no separate raw material and then knowledge coming together. Just like in your own dream, your own knowledge and your memories constitute the material for the dream, is it not? So, and your wishes and desires. So there are three things that are happening in that are the content of your dream: your memories, your knowledge and your desires. Lottery, 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 you're thinking during the daytime. And then dream. You think you are convinced, you have a dream that you have won, the winning number is on your dream ticket, right? So So now what? As a result of this, what are we going to do? You know, then the alarm rings. Then what happens? The dream is retracted into you. The same model here. See, just like your knowledge, your memories, and your desires are the raw material for your dream. This Jagat, Bhagavan's knowledge, Bhagavan has memories from the last Kalpa, from the last cycle of creation, you know, Satapo Tapyat thinks about the last cycle of creation. So Kamayat desire, Kama has come. So that Bhagavan's desire, so to speak, Bhagavan's memories from the last cycle of creation, and then what else? Bhagavan's knowledge, all knowledge, is projected onto this Jagat. Very beautiful. So there is now, this is called Abhinna Nimitta Upadana Karanam. The causation for this Jagat is, you know, rests in one conscious being. This is the Upanishad's, you know, vision. In the Upanishad's vision, the causation is not twofold like the pot. Like the pot has a twofold causation, the knowledge is in the head, non-separate from the potter, and then the material lies outside the potter. And so the potter has to go bring the material and craft the pot. But here, there is no bringing, because we are talking of that conscious being which is the only thing, Kevala, which is nothing other than itself. There is nothing other than it. There is nothing like it. There is no second thing. And it itself doesn't have parts. So Vijatiya Bheda, Svajatiya Bheda, and Swagata Bheda are absent. The three kinds of divisions. Vijatiya Bheda, something unlike it. Another Bhagavan. Another knowledgeable Bhagavan. No. And then Svajatiya Bheda. At least, you know, another Brahman, because Brahman is the raw material, you know, which is Bhagavan, really. So, another Brahman, from this Brahman, this Bhagavan came from that Brahman, another, no? Even in the same jati, same species, there is no difference. And finally, there is the third kind of difference is absent. Like a tree, one tree, many branches, one branch, many leaves, you know? Like one Brahman, many branches, no? Impartite, whole. So these three divisions are missing. So therefore, the knowledge and the material rests in the hands of a conscious being. Hands means don't think of hands, okay? Yeah. So hands means rests with this conscious being who is seen as Hara. But since the matter is what is seen and Hara is not locally available to see, why? Because the seer is Hara. The truth of the seer is Hara. There's only one seer. So since this Hara is not locally available for sight, you know what happens? There is this feeling that I can see the raw material that is manifest as so many bodies, so many minds, trees, mountains, rivers, streams. I can see all the raw materials. So then that is real. So the duality becomes real. And that this non-separateness from Bhagavan we don't see. And that becomes something to be understood later on when one is ready. Because one gets completely under the spell of this duality. And when you take this duality as the only reality, sorrow and fear ensue. This is the recipe for sorrow and fear. Taking the unreal to be real, and therefore, you know, that is one kind of mistake. And what is the other kind of mistake? Taking the unreal to be real and taking the real to be unreal. Yeah. Taking Atma for Anatma. What is Anatma? Not Atma. So taking the I to be not I. And then taking not I to be I. Taking the body to be I. Body is Anatma. Body is I. So taking Anatma, not I, to be I. So the body is an Atma, I say, I am as good as this body, I am as good as this mind. And what is the Atma? The Atma is Satchidananda, but taking it to be limited, I am sad, I am small, all these things. So it has got an Anyonya Adhyasa. a mutual superimposition between I and not I. Not I is frequently mistaken for the I, and because the I is not known, the I is further mistaken for various products of the not I. And this is the original problem. So here, therefore, first the three things are talked about. The raw material, you know, the maker, and then, you know, so that is what three things are talked about. Ksharam and, you know, Aksharam Haraha, and then, no, Aksharam here is probably, three things. Maya, Jagat, and then Bhagavan. Three things are talked about. And then what? The Maya, Jagat, and Bhagavan. Three things. Or you can count the three things slightly differently by another reading and say Maya. Maya is not talked about. Bhagavan. And then the material for the Jagat. And then Aham, the one who sees these two things. The one who is trying to bridge the gap between these two things. Who is that? The individual Atma, the individual Jiva. So Jiva, Jagat, Ishvara, our quintessential division is pointed out here. And then last time we saw that it was concluded that this Jagat, you know, is resolved. Now we only have Jiva and Ishvara, because the Jagat comes under Ishvara, correct? There is no Jagat without being Ishvara. Saha akamayata, saha apravishat. You know, first the Bhagavan desired, then Bhagavan created everything, and Bhagavan entered the very creation. So there is a non-separation between the raw material and Bhagavan. Those are reduced to two, and now we have only Jiva and Ishvara. And up till that we saw last time. Now continuing. So now there is Jiva and Ishvara. So now still there are two things. This is what, why one composes sad songs. When will you give darshan? How can you be so cruel to your, you know, to your children? How can you play hide and seek? How long you will play hide and seek? You have to show me what is going on. Show me your face. What do you look like? This is Arjuna's problem. Arjuna also wanted that. Then he got frightened in chapter 11. Correct? Why? Because he disincluded himself from the whole. That is what happens. Dvaitadhi bhayam bhavati, this Upanishad says, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says. He did not include himself in the whole. That is why he got scared. Because whenever there is dvaita, what is dvaita? Duality. Whenever there is dvaita, there is fear. Duality is the cause of fear, because something other than me, it makes me afraid. And so therefore, now what? Now we have a beautiful thing here. These two here have to be further reduced to one. How to do that? I see, first of all, if they were not already one, we couldn't reduce. They are already one. But why do they appear two? Because, you know, this head, the one that is seen two where two is not, is drunk with the samsara alcohol. So the person is samsaraholic, meaning totally is in samsara and doesn't know how to get out and doesn't want to get out on one level, because he's afraid that what will happen if I get out. So the person is caught in samsara. That's why I said samsaraholic, because it's addictive. And so here the person is, see, it's not really two. So there is no need to do a yojana. Yojana means a joining together. You can only join together two things that are separated. You cannot join together, you know, things that are already one. How are you going to join things that are not broken? You don't have to, you know, you can only join things that are not, that are, you know, separated by time. Okay, you bring them together. Maybe there is time travel. You bring them together. You go back in time and you right some wrongs and bring people together. Maybe that's one thing. Okay, maybe they are separated by space. One is here and one is in New York. Okay, then you bring, then also you can bring together. But here, the separating factors between Jiva and Ishvara are neither time nor space. What are they? What is the separating factor? Ignorance. What kind of ignorance? Self-ignorance, not ignorance of some chocolate or bonbons. You know, yeah. bonbon, if you are united with, you will get bonbon ananda. You know, chocolate ananda you will get. How long will it last? As long as the bonbon, that's what. So self, you know, self-knowledge. So one is the separating factor between Jiva and Ishvara from the standpoint of the Jiva. Because Ishvara doesn't think all these are Jivas. Ishvara says, they are all me. I am in every one of them. They are all non-separate from me. Who thinks I am separate? It is the Jiva. A point to note. It's not Ishvara who is saying, we have to unite the Jiva with me. No, Ishvara doesn't see any separation. Who sees? No, Jiva. Jiva sees. Why does Jiva see? Because of the self-ignorance. First is, there is two. The self-ignorance has two parts. I have told this before. Agrahanam, not grasping the truth. And then anyatha grahanam, therefore taking the truth to be other than what it is. Agrahanam and anyatha grahanam. So these are the two problems with the Jiva. So this twofold manifestation of that self-ignorance, two aspects. Agrahanam, not knowing what I am. All animals also have agrahanam. But what do they not have? Anyatha grahanam is not there for the animal. The cow may not know I am Brahman. You know, it will not say aham brahmasmi. But it also doesn't have a complex centered on the self. I'm not good enough. It doesn't have so many cows in its life, you know. I'm not good enough. Nobody loves me. They have left me alone in this pasture. They only want me for my milk. I have no value. This is all not there. This is anyatha grahana. This is an example. Neither does the dog think I have no degree. I have no pedigree. I'm just a mutt. I'm just a sad fellow. What should I do? What should I do to become more loved? And the cat certainly doesn't think that. Yeah. The cat thinks that your, you know, job in life is to be a can opener. That's all. It sees you as a life-size can opener. Yeah. And when it is food time, it will come. It's not thinking how to make this one love me more. That's the last thing on its mind. You know. So that is why. But do they know the self? No, they don't know the self. But then they also don't know, you know, they don't have this other problem of having a complex centered on the self. But the human being, without fail, you go from everywhere, you go from Alaska to Australia, every human being will say, are you happy? What will be the answer? Something in my life, okay. Some other things, like this, they will make a sign. And then what they will do? They will say, if the spouse listened to me, when? All the time. And if the, you know, children obeyed me, and if I had a lot of money in my hand and in the bank, in case the banks failed, and then if I had a lot of time, so because all this money should be coming without me working, and everybody should be telling me nice things, you know, about myself all the time. Nobody should criticize. Nobody should say you're not doing this properly. Nobody should say, have anything harsh. Nobody should be impatient. Everybody should be dharmic towards me. But I can be adharmic as much as I want, you know. Then I'll be happy. Can anybody fulfill all those conditions? No. And in the afternoon class, we saw that the one who has everything is still unhappy. We saw that in the Panchadashi. So what does this signify? This signifies one particular thing. That this anyatha grahanam, this not knowing I am Brahman, not knowing I am Bhagavan, it causes a lot of problems. That is what is the fruit of this duality. This so-called, this apparent duality becomes real because of the anyatha grahana. I take everything to be as real as myself. Every tree, every shrub, every body is real, and all the problems in the world are real, and everything is real. So it's just like the pot who had a complex. I'm crackpot, I'm not pot, what happened to me, why I'm so small, the bigger pots will come and eat me up. This is the complex. And if it has a complex, what is advised? Where should it go? It should go to pot guru. Yeah. Guru potananda, it should go to. And then it should say, Adhi Bhagavan, Brahma vidyam, it wants, hey, you know, clay avidyam parishtam. Yeah, it is, it wants clay vidya. It doesn't want Brahma vidya because its redemption is in knowing that all that is here is clay. Correct? Yeah. Adhihi Bhagavan, you know, mrit vidyam parishtam. Mrit means clay. So teach me the knowledge of clay, the most exalted knowledge. Yaya tirat, by which. Atirat, not long from hence, sarva papam vyapohya, having got rid of all the papas, parat param kleyam yati patam. You know, this is this is what it will say. By, teach me this knowledge by which the all-powerful, all-pervasive, you know, the god called clay is known, by which all the papas go away and I will become one with that ultimate clay. So I will become one with that ultimate clay. Are you not one with clay already? What are you? Is pot separate from clay? Huh? If it is, please take the pot and leave the clay with me. Here, you can have this pot. On one condition, leave the clay, you take the pot. Is it possible? So then, the pot is succumbing to pot duality, because there's always bada pot which can eat the chota pot, finished, gone. And it's making a noise from inside, help! Trahimam, Tahimam! In Mahamrityunjaya mantra it is saying, Rambakam yajamahe chubandhyam prithivardhan Purvarkamiva bandhanam mrityo mukshiya mahamrita. And then what will Guru Potananda say? Guru Potananda will say, I am clay, you are clay, we are all clay, everything here is clay, clay idam sarvam, clayya vasyam idam sarvam, not isha vasyam. And then, you know, the pot will become an enlightened pot, previously cracked pot, now enlightened cracked pot. So the cracks don't matter because it is not, no longer thinking of itself as a small pot. And so what happens now? Then it says, it doesn't matter if I'm small, because truly I know I'm all. Correct? So I don't have to become clay, because I'm already clay. Then the pot will have another very famous question. What is that? Guru. Guru. My Guru? Walk it in. Yeah. Guru. Yes. I have one more question. Yes, what is it? I know I'm clay. How to experience clay? You know? Study the Shvetashvatara Upanishad. That's all we have to say. So like this, first that multiplicity and the idea of the multiverse, first we have this vast jagat, then we have the one who is saying this is the vast jagat, that is the jiva. And then we have the same one who is saying the maker of the jagat is aval, absent without leave, has gone missing. Where is the maker? Correct? So we have three things. So then we establish that the maker and the material are one and the same. So now we are left with how many things? Two things. Go step by step. Yeah, what's the hurry? So two. Two things. Correct? Who are the two things? Jiva and the Jagat. Correct? So now, sorry, Jiva and Ishvara. Jagat is resolved into Ishvara. So now we have Jiva and Ishvara. Now the question is, how do we, you know, simmer this down to one and the only? That is the question. And here it is given through the invocation of Bhagavan. One overcomes the difference. And the knowledge, of course. So through invocation, worship, and oneness with Bhagavan. So here, this is very important for all the experience buffs. And the experience buffs, you know, want to experience Bhagavan and experience this oneness. All right. Experience it by surrendering the limited, which is oneself, or in one's perception, at the altar that is limitless. So when the limited surrenders to the limitless, you know, Kim Shesham, what is left? The limitless alone can be left. Because the limited is included in the limitless, is it not? Does not the limitless, the limited, get included in the limitless? Yes, limitless includes everything, including the limited. But if the limited is feeling away and separate, what is advised is here, Karma Yoga, which is, see, Bhagavad Aradhana, Puja, and becoming one with Bhagavan, at least during Puja. Because in the Puja, there is Soham Bhavena Pujayet. I am that Bhagavan only, that kind of Bhavana is there. And the only, when you show the, what is that, the camphor lamp, the mantra, that it is so beautiful. You say that, you know, may I know the truth of myself. I dare to light you up, you know, with this miserable camphor of light, camphor light. You who are the light of all lights, light up my mind so that I can recognize this as myself. This is the bhavana. So what happens because of this oneness and meditation and puja and all these sadhanas, antaranga sadhana, bahiranga sadhana, and the sadhanas, antaranga sadhana, meditation, bahiranga sadhana, karma yoga, etc. So what happens as a result of that is that the ego diminishes in size and one becomes prayerful, humble, and qualified for the knowledge. All this we have to see. Later on it will come. One becomes qualified for this knowledge, and karma yoga plus knowledge is a deadly combination which will truly free. This is what is said here. So then through this repeated aradhana of Ishvara, what happens? Vishva maya nivritti. What is this Vishva maya? The ignorance that is standing in between Jiva and Ishvara. In between Jiva and Ishvara, what is there? Maya. Maya. Actually, the maya, the chaya of maya, the shadow of maya. And so what is this maya? The maya is all knowledge, that which makes Bhagavan all knowledgeable, and that which makes the jiva totally bound, entangled in notions of finitude. This is maya. Vishva Maya means that Maya which is all pervasive, all powerful. Maya is the which is everything. So Vishva Maya, Vishva Maya Yaha Nivrittihi. Nivrittihi means what? That ignorance resolves in the wake of knowledge. And this Maya has twofold powers. What are the two powers of Maya? Vikshepa. What is Vikshepa? The power of projection. Then what is the other power? Avarna, the concealing power. What does it project? What does she project? She projects the one, she scatters the one into many, Vikshepa. And then what does she cover? The knowledge that all this is one. And this is a double jeopardy here. First, the one is scattered into many, and this is what we call Ishvara Srishti. Ishvara Srishti, Ishvara's creation. And then she robs the jiva, she covers the jiva so that the jiva no longer has the eyes to see this spoof. So the covers the one, you know, conceals the one from oneself. This is very all powerful she is. This is not an ordinary maya, she is a great, you know. Parabrahma Jaya. Jaya means the consort of Parameshwara, this maya is. Because she co-creates the Jagat along with Bhagavan. That is why all the manifestations of Bhagavan in the Hindu tradition, they are all happily married. You will not find a single singleton, you know. Yeah. No, but what about Dakshinamurti? Half feminine. So it's already there. Left hand side is feminine. That's why there are two separate different earrings. If you look closely, right hand side is the male earring and the left hand side is the female earring. It's very clean. Even Ganesha has Riddhi and Siddhi as the consorts. So that shows that the power which is coded as feminine is non-separate from the knowledge. It is resting in one conscious being. And so here there is this vikshepa and this avarana, the twofold powers. And the only person that doesn't come under the spell of this power is the conscious being, Ishvara. Ishvara cannot come under the spell of Maya. Why? He is called Mayin. Mayin means what? Not in Maya. No, that is Jiva. Jiva is in Maya. Ishvara is Mayin. You have to do opposite. Mayin means the wielder of Maya. Yeah. Sharirin, there are certain words. Dhanin, the wielder of wealth. So Mayin, Jiva. But somehow it's lopsided. Mayin, Ishvara. And the Jiva is what? In Maya. How did this happen? What happened over here? This is the two powers. Mayin doesn't come under the spell of these powers. In Maya, the one who is in Maya comes under the spell of these powers. So this is Vishva Maya. And so now there is Vikshepa and Avarna. Avarna, my inability to see that all is one. Vikshepa, the projection in the form of the Jagat, the manifold projection. Now in order to gain a moksha, to gain enlightenment, what do I have to overcome? Do I have to overcome Vikshepa or Avarna? Avarna. Why? Because Vikshepa cannot be overcome. Why cannot Vikshepa be overcome? Because it was there before, you know, your body, your mind, your senses were born. And if Vikshepa is overcome, then the body, mind, sense complex will also just melt down. So who will be there to say, I know Brahman? Yeah, because everything becomes one, correct? If Vikshepa is overcome. Vikshepa is the Jagat in the form of the Ishvara Srishti, the so-called creation, which is more of a projection. The projection is taken back by the one who projected it, correct? How can you take back somebody else's projection? You cannot take back. You cannot do that. You can do your child's homework, okay. But you know, the grade will still come to the child. You cannot say, I did the homework, you know. I need the grade. So you can help out the child with the homework. But so same thing here. You can manipulate the vikshepa of Ishvara. So many vikshepas are there. You can do genetic modification. You can do cloning. You can do all these, you know, grafting and cutting and pasting and stem cells. You can do all that. But it is within this rubric of the manifest Jagat, correct? Yeah. It's within that power alone. But you cannot say clap, clap and withdraw the manifestation. You cannot do that. Why? Because you are not the manifestor. In fact, even your own dream is within the larger manifestation. Mm. So even though you think I'm having a very good dream, but I'm having this recurrent dream that before the lottery numbers are fully read, I wake up. Supposing if you say, I want to continue this dream a little longer. Are you able to continue it? Hardly at all. Your own power to manifest in the form of the dream is, you know, severely inhibited. Why? Because it comes under the larger vikshepa. Your dream is part of the vikshepa. Your own vikshepa is part of the vikshepa. And then during the waking, you also have other vikshepas during waking. What is that vikshepa? Nobody loves me. I'm an idiot. My own projection. This is called Jiva Srishti. Nobody cares about me. All my friends are fair weather friends. They only want things from me. I'm not going to be successful. No matter how I try, somebody else gets the credit. Even if I get moksha, somebody else will take the credit. How? I don't know. I'm just saying. For the Jiva, any kind of complex is possible, correct? Because Jiva is a complex fellow. So this Jiva will say all kinds of things. So these are Jiva also has projections. Yeah, Jiva also has projections. And then guess what? Does Jiva have Avarna? Yes, Jiva has Avarna. What is that Avarna? The unconscious. That part of the psychological part of which was hidden from view, which is hidden from view because it happened when it was 2, when the Jiva was 3, when the Jiva was 4, maybe up to 4 or 5, the unconscious forms. All the memories of the trauma buried, avarna. This is avarna. And then vikshepa. Therefore, nobody loves me. Therefore, I'm alone. Therefore, I'm abandoned. Just based on two parents, you know. Yes, granted, they are fallible, but how much can two people do, really? What can they achieve? You know, because of two people, the whole view is just completely topsy-turvy. One sees what is not there, and then one sees what is, you know, what one is, what is there, one does not see. This is just, you know, this is very interesting. So the jiva has vikshepa in the night, in the form of dream, which is part of Bhagavan's vikshepa. And the jiva has, you know, vikshepa during the day, which is part of Bhagavan's avarna. This is Maya's avarna, which is the result of it is your vikshepa. Look at the paradoxy here. Mm. It's so fantastic. That covering of Maya translates in the mind of the jiva as a projection that nobody likes me and I'm alone and I'm abandoned. The personal projection of the jiva is the covering of the Maya. So at the collective level, the avarna becomes a vikshepa. At the individual level, it's very interesting. And Bhagavan's vikshepa, which is what? Which is the unconscious, becomes the avarna for the jiva. Very, very interesting. So then you said you have to remove the avarna in order to come out of Maya. You are very unanimous in that. Which avarna are you going to remove? The unconscious? Or the fact that I cannot see anything as one? That one you are going to remove, correct? Yeah. Why? Because that vikshepa, Bhagavan's vikshepa, you did not create. You cannot take back. But the ajnanam belongs to who? You or Bhagavan? Who does the ajnanam belong to? The one who says, I am in suffering. To that person, the ajnanam belongs. So the responsibility lies with oneself to remove this ajnanam by exposing oneself to the teachings. This is my answer to the question which people have been asking. Why can't Bhagavan give me moksha? I have told you. Bhagavan cannot give you moksha because you are already free. It's like praying to Bhagavan and saying, I want a head on my shoulders. I have told you this. And what will Bhagavan say? I can give you another head. I can give you upar niche, like double decker. Back to back, side by side, in any other combination you want. But I can't give you a head because you already have it. Moksha is your nature. And if you are being kept from moksha, it's only because you don't know it. Bhagavan can bless you to seek the knowledge. Bhagavan can bless you to have a teacher who will teach. Bhagavan will bless you to give a mind that will understand this. But Bhagavan cannot give you moksha because you already are free. This is what one has to understand. And this is what is being told here. That this vikshepa is, you know, the vikshepa is not causing samsara. Maya Shakti's power called vikshepa is not causing, you know, samsara. Because there are so many trees, so many bushes, so many rivers, so many mountains. They are not causing a problem. Then what is it that is causing a problem? That I see them as discrete entities, correct? That is avarna. So the avarna causes the problem. Avarna removed through self-knowledge, avarna is gone. Then let the vikshepa continue, correct? Let the vikshepa continue. On the collective level, let Bhagavan's srishti continue. If your drishti has changed, then the srishti doesn't matter. Drishti means vision. If your drishti has changed, then the srishti can be as, however it is, because you have an objective drishti, now you are not looking at the srishti with a subjective drishti. So your drishti has totally changed. And so the srishti cannot cause problems, it was never causing problems. And the same thing on the individual level. On the individual level, you withdraw the vikshepa, not the avarna, because avarna God made. What is the avarna? The unconscious. The unconscious is a gift from Bhagavan so that the child can grow up normally and deal with the pain and sorrow later on in life when it has the wherewithal to do it. So your avarna is part of Bhagavan's vikshepa. So you cannot remove it on the individual level. But what can you withdraw? Your own vikshepa, your own personal projections. You see, it's so beautiful. At the individual and the collective level, it just is so fantastic. So this is Vishvamaya in all her aspects. So the avarna removed, Vishvamaya yaha nivrittihi. There is nothing more to do. And that's what the next verse is going to say. That once this is achieved, there is nothing more to know. There is nothing more to do. All is already gained. Jnatva devam.
सर्वपाशापहानिहि क्षीणैहि
क्लेशैर्जन्म
मृत्युप्रहाणिः
तस्याभिध्यानात्
तृतीयं देहभेदे विश्वैश्वर्यं केवल आप्तकामः
विश्वैश्वर्यं केवल आप्तकामः
सो लेट अस लुक एट द ट्रांसलेशन ज्ञात्वा नोइंग हैविंग नोन व्हाट देवम हु इज दिस देवम भगवान द एफल्जेंट वन The effulgent one who is non-separate from the self-effulgent one. Who is the self-effulgent one? I. And who is Devam? The truth of this I. Then what happens? Sarva-pasha apahanihi. Apahanihi means the destruction. The loss. The loss of what? Sarva-pasha. All the chains and fetters are shackles fall away. Kshinaihi kleshaihi. Klesha here is papa punya. Kshinaihi. Kshina means the waning away of all the papa punya happens as a result of this knowledge. Janma mrityu prahanihi. And the cycle of birth and death is also destroyed. Tasya abhidhyanat. Through this oneness, abhidhyana also means meditation, invocation. Invocation here more like contemplation with understanding. Tritiyam is the third one. Who is this third one? The jiva. Deha bhede, transcending this body consciousness. Body consciousness means what? Dehatma buddhi. I am this body iti. Vishwa aishwaryam. Vishwa aishwaryam is the universal overlordship of everything. Kevalaha, the one who is without a second is gained, and the person becomes aptakamaha. Completely satisfied at all times, gained everything. The one who has aptaha kamaha yena aptakamaha. The one by whom all desires are gained is called aptakama. So this is the translation. So here jnatva deva. So it doesn't say, you know, even though it talks about all these things, abhidhyana, Yojana, Tattva Bhava, etc. Tattva Bhava means knowledge. Ultimately, the Upanishad here concludes Jnatva. Having known how, not knowing it as an object. Nedam Yadidam Upasate. tadeva brahmatvam vidhi. The student in the Keno Upanishad is told, nedamyadidam upasate. The Keno Upanishad is very beautiful because it talks about Brahman in a very interesting way, as non-separate from oneself in a very beautiful and an immediate way. The student asks the question, you know, keneshitam preshitam patati manaha, impelled by whom does the mind fall into various thoughts? Kena pranaha prathamam praiti, how do the thoughts fall into the mind? How does the prana go out and in? Who is the one behind my eyes that see? Who is the one that is making me hear? Is there a force? And what is that force? And what is the relationship of myself to that force? This is the opening question of the student. Think of how much the student already knows to ask this question. And the teacher, highly pleased, gives a beautiful and a cryptic answer. Shrotrasya shrotram manaso manoyat vajoha vacham sau pranasya pranaha. So what you are asking for is not the eye. The eyes don't see. It's the eye of the eye. Pun intended. It's the eye behind the eye. Eye of the eye. The ear of the ear. The prana of the life force of the life force. That which in itself does not require to breathe to be sentient, to be alive. And then what? And this is the one. Bhuta Yonim. This is the source of all beings. This is Bhagavan. This is you. This is what the teacher says. So, and then a series of things come. What is this eye of the eye? Very beautiful. Another text, Drik Drishya Viveka, says this beautifully. You know, rupam drishyam. Rupam means the form. When the form is the object, drishyam, object. Lochanam drik. Who is the seer? The eyes. So if the flower is the object, who is the seer of the flower? The eyes. But then supposing I am not seeing properly, something is in the eye. Then I go to the mirror and look at the eyes. Then who is the seer? The mind. Mind is the seer. The mind itself is seen because I say, now I am happy, now I am restless, now I want to go home, now I want to go eat ice cream. So I am always saying that, correct? So the mind is always saying that, but who comes to know that the mind is saying that? I come to know the mind is saying that. Who is this I? Sakshi, the witness. Rupam drishyam lochanam drik tadrishyam, you know, tadrishtva driktu manasam drishyadhi vrittayas sakshi drigevana chudnatu drishyate. And then who is this sakshi? How do I see this sakshi and greet this sakshi? Drik eva, that ultimate seer is never seen. Why? It's you. There's nothing more mysterious about that. It's you. No, but why can't I see myself? Because you're not the object, you're the subject. But then how will I know I am? How do you know you are? Are you here? That's why I keep asking this question. Are you here? Yes. Yeah? Yes? No? Yes?
Yes.
You have to say I'm here. Because if you say no, you're still advertising yourself. Correct? So you can't deny yourself. And so the student in the Keno Upanishad is told that this seer is everything. And this seer is alone Brahman. Not that which you worship every day. So what is this? What is this? What? Not that which I worship? Not that which you worship as an object. Yeah. It's the very subject. And all the objects resolve into the subject. Subject never resolves. Subject is never subject to resolution. That is the subject. So the subject is always the subject. The object is also the subject. But the subject is not the object. Got it? Mm-hmm. That is what it is. So here, Nyatma Devam, उच्यते सर्वपाशैः सर्वपाशापहानिः सेम थिंग सर्वपाश अपहानिः सो व्हेन आई नो दिस ट्रूथ विच ट्रूथ द वन आई जस्ट सेड दैट द ऑब्जेक्ट्स आर नॉन सेपरेट फ्रॉम द सब्जेक्ट ऑल ऑब्जेक्ट्स आर द प्रोजेक्शन ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट एंड दे रिजॉल्व इनटू दैट वेरी सब्जेक्ट सब्जेक्ट डज नॉट रिजॉल्व इनटू एनीथिंग Object resolves into subject. Subject is uniquely itself without resolving into anything, a single thing. When this is understood as the truth, all fetters go away. And what are the fetters? The fetters of smallness, the fetters of limitedness, the fetters of all kinds of, you know, wrong thinking, the fetters of subjectivity go away. And then क्षीणैः पुण्यैः क्षीणैः क्लेशैः सो ऑल द पापा पुण्य आल्सो गोज अवे ऑल कर्मा गोज अवे क्लेशा हियर इज कर्मा एंड व्हेन द कर्मा गोज अवे इज देयर द बर्थ और डेथ इज देयर नो इट कैन नॉट बी देयर बिकॉज द रॉ मटेरियल फॉर बर्थ एंड डेथ रिपीटेड साइकिल ऑफ बर्थ एंड डेथ इज कर्मा एंड व्हेन द कर्मा इज गॉन पुफ There is no more birth and death. And since there is no more birth and death, then the person is does not have to endure few more cycles of ignorance and separation. Tritiyam, the third one, doesn't have to endure any cycles of separation. And even while embodied, does not think I am as good as this body. And when that happens, the person is freed from all wantingness. A little more involved, we will see that next time. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi
Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha
Hari Om. Any questions?
Which is a kind of question. It seems that the path to knowledge may proceed in a couple different ways. And it's what you have explained from the Upanishad is that first the Prakriti is resolved into the Ishvara, and then leaving the Jiva and Ishwara, or Bhagavan. And then through worshipping Ishwara and understanding what his nature is, you understand your own nature and you become that one subject. It seems, when I read people's mystical experiences, I have had an interest in this, and when I listen to people when they tell me about their peak experiences, what I usually hear is that the most common experience is the feeling of oneness with all that is. Like people go out in nature, they feel like the oneness with nature first, and they feel that there's no separation between themselves and the tree or other people. But to feel that, I very rarely hear people get to the prime subject, what they feel is the oneness. So is this not like feeling the clayness, like you were talking about the clay, getting into the clay nature, or getting into the Prakriti or Pradhana nature? I think this is what I hear people, is more accessible to people.
Well, you know, the thing is, when you get one with, let's say you're in the mountains, and you become, you feel oneness with the mountain, you have an not that you are separate from the mountains, but you have this blast of an experiential oneness with the mountains, the river, the trees, as you pointed out. Now, I think that it's not Prakriti, I would say. I would say it is the Bhagavan behind the mountain, because the Prakriti is manifold. But here the person is feeling one with everything. So it's still the subject. Maybe a sudden, spontaneous experience of oneness without the knowledge per se of what this all is. And but still that experience has to do with the subject, because the nature is not experiencing anything and it is a manifest universe. And the tree, even though I say all is one, the tree is still separate from another tree, and the bush is separate from another bush, and the squirrel is separate from its predators, for example. So like this, nothing has changed. What has changed? The srishti, which is the, srishti means the creation, has not changed. What has changed is my drishti. So the drishti and is what influences the srishti. I can see it as many, I can see it as one, I can see it as me. So really all experiences are centered on the experiencer, who is forgotten in the whole thing, because it's all that oneness. So then when you analyze the experience, that is knowledge, because any analysis is a cognitive understanding. So you're trying to know, that is knowledge.
But the thing about this oneness experience, which people commonly have, is that it lacks the feeling of lordship or ishitva you don't have. You just feel the oneness.
That is Ishitva. That is Ishitva. That lordship is Ishitva, because the lordship is self-mastery, there's nothing else. Yeah, that oneness is that, that oneness with everything. That Isha is given here. That Ishitru, or that feeling of Aishwarya, is given here for the people who are questioning, why should I study this? Aptakama is given here. It's not that people have, who are feeling oneness are having all their desires fulfilled. No, they are not, you know. But apta kama, the word is there, the one who has gained all the desires and is the overlord of all. Because the feeling that brings one to the teaching is that I am incomplete and I am small and I am wanting. And that person is told, no, no, you are not small, you are one with Ishvara, you are the overlord of all. You know. And we are not looking for the experience of oneness. If it is there, well and good. But there's not, we are not trying to replicate an experience of oneness, because an experience by nature is finite. There is a time, for a time being you are one, and then you come back to this. So here through knowledge, you are one all the time, even in the so-called multiplicity. We are not, you know, bothered by the multiplicity. That is what we want. That is a sane way of approaching it. That is what, you know, the Upanishad teaches, that regardless of how you feel, you are still one with everything. Yeah. Here is a question, a very interesting one. Let's see, where did that question go? Maybe a little further up it is. How can a karma like marriage be removed by self-knowledge? So, you know, first of all, you know, we are talking of everything we have to, in Vedanta you add as though to everything. First of all, marriage can be very helpful for self-knowledge. You don't need to remove it. Yeah. Because marriage has perhaps brought people to, many people to self-knowledge. That is its power. So that is the power of marriage, is that after living with somebody for a few years, you say, you run to Bhagavan, you say that, you know, you say, please show me my nature. So, you know, so the marriage has been successful, because that's what the marriage is for. That is its purpose. That's what the marriage is for. In the Hindu Dharma, that is what the marriage is for. It's so that both the people can, you know, can pursue this knowledge together. And if both the people cannot, at least one person prods the other person to go. May not be saying go, but create certain situations that they go. So marriage is always a means to an end. It's never an end in itself. If we think of the marriage as an end, it will end. That is what we say. So therefore, so marriage need not be removed. Your drishti about the marriage can be removed. That's all. Marriage can continue. Yeah. You need not be married the same way that you were. The dysfunctionality is gone. Yes?
So did I hear you correctly? I don't think it was once a was relation to this, but another, that moksha is actually not an experience.
Moksha is not an experience.
Thank you.
Yeah. Moksha is you. It's you. Yeah. It is one of the quickest ways for Vairagya. That is well said. Well said. Yeah. Fast train to Vairagya. Yes. Then, so I understand the Advaita, that I am not just part of that divine, but I get confused at the very end that we will resolve into him at the end or at the time of Pralaya. Why Pralaya? Even now you are one. Why you have to wait to Pralaya? You don't have to wait. Like just like this, you know, after going to Potananda, what happened to this one? This one knows that this name and form called pot is just as though. It is still clay. It doesn't have to have little pot pralaya in order to become one with clay. Correct? Mm-hmm. Like that, yeah. My drishti changes the srishti. My drishti, which triggers my perception, changes the way I look at the world. Correct? You understood, you got it. Anything else? All right. Oh.